Ooh.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to the Weave Lab Day. This Weave Lab Day is welcoming the Early Dance Circle. I believe you can see me. Yes. Hello, everyone. Now I can see more of your faces. Welcome. My name is Rosa Maria Cisneros, and I am part of the Coventry Uni Center for Dance Research team. Other team members include Marie-Louise Crawley and Sarah Watley. They are part of the Weave project and team, and I see there are other team members from the project also in the space. It gives me great pleasure to welcome the Early Dance Circle. We have several committee members in the audience, but also we are here with Sharon Butler, Bill Tuck, and Barbara Siegel. Chris Gill will also be part of the presentation. Before we get into the Early Dance part of our day, I will do a quick introduction to Weave, also do some housekeeping. Please do use the chat. We are using the chat, so if you want to share where you're based, where institution, if you'd like to offer your contact details, so we want to make this as lively as possible. The lab day methodology is about different bodies, different people, different profiles in the space, sharing their expertise and also looking at different, let's say, gaps or questions or any problems. And so thinking about that, but we're not in body to body. We are in this virtual space. So let's try to make the most of it. Please do feel free to keep your cameras on. We do have, for those that would like to have a live transcript, at the bottom of your screen, we have that option available. You need to turn that on or off. For any questions, technical questions, please do message my colleague, Kozer Hussein, who's hosting the space with me, and she's our tech guru for the day. For those that would benefit from an audio description, I am a female sitting in a cream-colored chair. I'm wearing a navy blue jacket with olive skin tone, reddish lipstick. My dark black hair is pulled up, and I'm wearing two golden earrings and a big necklace. As we've said, we like to make our spaces as inclusive as possible. So feel free to, yes, use this as respectfully as you'd like. There will be a time for questions and answers. We will do also a mini poll right at the beginning. Well, actually, we can do that poll now since it's right before the My Weave presentation. Hopefully you can see this poll. I will read the question. The first question is, how many people are aware of your piano? The second question is there a digital archive you have used in the past? Please use the chat if you want to offer specifics around which archive and when. Question three, have you written a response to archives? That can be a creative response, a performative response, an academic response. There are four questions, so please do scroll down. Question number four, have you created a performance response to archive? Oh, there was a different question there. I forgot my own questions. Question four, have you created a performance response to archival material? So I know there are a few people in the space that have some experience with that. So let's see the poll results. Hopefully you can see the results now. To question one, 67% said yes. Not bad. Question two, 58% said yes. Question three, 75% said no. And question four, 92% said no. Okay. Yes. And this meeting is being recorded. It will go public, but during the registration process, you have already consented to that. But if you'd like to not be viewed publicly, do let me know, and we can also make sure that your video is off and that so any questions so far? Okay, I will begin my presentation, very brief presentation on Weave, the project, who we are, what we're trying to do. Hopefully you can see that screen. Yes. As I said, I'm Rosa Cisneros, and I'm at Coventry University Center for Dance Research. My colleagues, Marie-Louise Crawley and Sarah Watley, who I believe are also in the space, are part of the team. Together, we are working on this project, which is a European project that's co-financed by the European Union under the Connecting Europe Facility Program to enrich Europeana with great content of tangible and intangible heritage and to develop new tools. We have several strands of our work that we are delivering. The lab days are one strand of that work. The Europeana website is about inspiring cultural heritage from across Europe at your fingertips. It has 50 million items to engage with, to play with, to create with, to learn from. And part of our work within Weave is to aggregate, to add content to Europeana. I love this mission statement from Europeana. So I'll just read it because I think it's a beautiful reflection of what they're doing, but how it's influencing the project. It says, our mission, and I quote, "We transform the world with culture. We want to build on Europe's rich heritage and make it easier for people to use, whether for work, for learning, or just for fun," end quote. And I just love that because I think At Europeana, they have thousands of European archives and libraries and museums, and they want to continue to develop the way that people use and explore and engage with the material. And so Europeana's collections provide access to over 50 million digitized items that can include books and music and artworks and many, many more. They have sophisticated search and filter tools to help you find what you're looking for. They also have different collections and thematic blogs, galleries and exhibitions. Within Weave, we're also developing different many collections and blogs and exhibitions. So do stay tuned and watch the space for that, to see how we do that. We know the importance of tangible and intangible cultural heritage. Within Weave, we're looking at intangibles, so dance through Portuguese folk dance, early dance, also other dance styles and forms with flamenco, contemporary, modern dance. But we're also looking at building. So we have partners, Arctur in Slovenia, who are looking at monuments and castles. We are working with the Roma community and looking at minority communities and how content is gathered, how it's tagged, the language, the stories that emerge from that. So with our partners at ARIAC, they are in tasked with looking at collecting and also having and hosting several lab days. Within Weave, we're developing a framework for linking and presenting the connections between tangible and intangible heritage, cultural communities, and bringing them to the center of attention by making them accessible in Europeana. And yes, so without further ado, it gives me great pleasure to welcome the Early Dance Circle, which is an ongoing collaboration. It started with the Culture Moves project, and we'll learn a little bit about that in today's lab day. But we've continued to work side by side. The Early Dance Circle is collaborating with the Center for Dance Research, offering us content and also helping us look at early dance. And they supported the Early Dance Baroque Dance MOOC that we developed within Culture Moves, and we're bringing that material back and reusing it again and looking at how students might continue to engage with that material and what questions and how we can continue to develop and connect those dots. So without further ado, Kozer, if we could have the slide and over to Sharon Butler.
Hello, everyone. The EDC is on show today for really quite a rare occasion for us. We're a national umbrella organization for historical dance, and we've been one for 40 years, though I must admit, not the world's best known one. We count among our members amateurs and professionals, and we try to raise the profile of early or historical dance, which is an area very little explored. It's not on the curriculum of any dance school regularly in the UK, though there might be occasional classes. And we have a very serious mission, but I also want to add that most of us are here to have fun. So today I'd like to introduce our chairman, Bill Tuck, and he will start us off.
I think we need you to unmute yourself, Bill and Barbara. Yeah.
We're now unmuted. Firstly, I'd like to thank Rosa and the team at Coventry for inviting us to participate in this project, Weave and Europeana. For us, in this period of constraint on actual live dancing and in company, it has actually been a very valuable exercise in going through our own archives and collecting material for these very important projects. And it's for that I think we're most grateful, the opportunity to participate and to do something to make sensible and valuable use of our current situation. Can you go back one slide and we'll look at the mission statement. As Sharon mentioned, we are essentially an umbrella organisation. Our membership consists of individuals, but also, and perhaps primarily, small groups of locally based who are interested in this area of historical early dance. And to clarify, by early dance, we generally mean social dance from before around 1900, but also to include what one might regard as stage dance or performance dance from perhaps earlier than 1800. So it is a very broad spectrum of dance, much of which was associated with the court circles within Europe as a whole. So our repertoire is quite broad, and it is not restricted just to things that happened in the UK. Now, as it says here, our mission is to promote the enjoyment of performance and the study of historical dance. Historical dance is something, has been something of an orphan within the general dance world. If one compares it to early music, for example, we don't really have quite such a high profile within the awareness of the public at large. And this is something that we want to change. So in promoting early dance, we want to give it something of the importance within the public perception that may be akin to that which early music has. We have been running for about 35 years, more than 35, probably nearer to 39 years. So we've been venturing upon this path of making the public aware of historical dance for quite some time. As part of this question of raising the profile of early dance, research is very important. It is a significant part of our cultural heritage, and we have to locate and verify the material which we use. There are ample sources from which we can produce sources involving choreographies, notations, step notations, descriptions of performance, and so on. There is quite a large amount of textual and descriptive information about historical dance, and this is something which we are endeavouring to convey into the archive of Europeana and along with Weave. As it says in the research. Yes, for the on that score, we're not only dancers, but we're also historians, musicians, costumiers, enthusiasts, and specialists of many different kinds in order to bring this material to the fore as regards public perception. The value of dance in animating historical buildings and engaging the wider public, the wider community, either as audience or as participant, is incalculable. And I noticed Rosa mentioned earlier the importance of buildings within the archive. Animating buildings with dance is one of the best ways of showing bringing these to life and bringing them to the foreground of public perception. In that respect, historical dance enriches the cultural life of the UK, not just the UK, it is actually much wider than that, it goes throughout Europe and further abroad as well. And it's part of our shared heritage and is of international importance. It belongs to us all. Can we have the next slide and I'll see. Thanks. From our own point of view, one of the great values of the society, the Early Dance Circle, is that it brings a sense of community to the to the individuals and to the groups who are involved in this activity. Can we go back one? This is my last back one slide. No, no. That's the one, our aims. To see that I've missed anything, yes, we act as a focal point to disseminate new information within the community as dancers re-examine the historical treatises. So our endeavor is based very much on sources, on authentic sources of information, historical documents, descriptions, and so on. And these are continually, new sources are continually coming to light. So it is a serious historical process in learning about this. Lastly, on our aims, early dance in all periods is a beautiful art form. So the aesthetic value of dance is not to be underestimated, both as an opportunity for creative expression, recreation, and new forms. It can serve as the basis for creating new forms of dance in a modern context. Yes, and I think that's all I have from this slide from the course. Oh, one other point I think I have mentioned, the context of early dance: courts, country houses, village squares, assembly rooms, or theatres, all valuable, incredibly valuable buildings and part of our tangible heritage. We are the we provide the intangible content for this tangible heritage. And can I have the following slide to see if I've covered everything? Who are we? Well, as I've said earlier, we are an umbrella organization. We have some 150 or so paid up members, but 180. But of course, our domain of dissemination is much broader than that through our publications and communications with others. It's controlled. We have a committee of 12, several technical assistants. We're all volunteers. We have no paid staff, no premises. Yes. Oh, and we have, this is actually quite important, we have very good contacts with other partner societies, including Lute Society, Tabor Society, One Dance UK, which is the general umbrella organisation for dance within the UK, the Centre for Dance Research at Coventry, Rose's group. We have a very substantial collection of material up in Oxford at the Kellogg College Library. And likewise, our sister organization, the Historical Dance Society, has very good links with us, and we do participate in a number of joint activities. I think with that, my 6 minutes is probably up, and I will pass the next allocation of time onto my glamorous assistant, Barbara Siegel, who is the membership committee of the Early Dance Circle. And she's going to tell you more about the specific activities that we are engaged in as an organization. Barbara.
So we have three main events: the festival, lecture, conference, and other things. Every year, the Early Dance Circle hosts a festival, and all groups from all over the country come together and present either a short show or individual dancers. They come together to show other people what they've been doing all the year and also to have fun. And we usually have about 12 to 15 groups and about 150 people attending the festival. And it's not just one afternoon, it's a whole weekend. And we start on a Friday night with a talk on some relevant topic. And on the Sunday, a visit to something like a stately home. So it's a very sociable event, and everybody can meet and socialize with fellow early dancers. For the past 2 years, we've been forced to hold the festival online. So we've collected pieces from mostly from old videos from old festivals, but some people have done COVID-safe performances and videoed them, and we have shown those. We sincerely hope the next year's festival will be live at Tring next October. So Rosa now will show a short clip from a compilation of various festivals.
Yes, I will. And suddenly my screen. Oh, one moment, please.
Here we go.
Rosa, I think we need the sound, please.
Now?
Perfect.
Thank you.
back to Barbara. I think we need to unmute you, Barbara. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Rosa. I hope you've got a taste of what we do. But we'll move on to the lecture now. So our second kind of event. Every year, the Early Dance Circle hosts a lecture on some aspect of dance history. Everyone's welcome, members and non-members. And after the lecture, we have a social gathering where we get together and talk about the lecture and other dance matters. We have an archive of all our lectures dating back to 1988. And there's a transcript of all the lectures from 2003, which you can find on the Early Dance Circle website. During the pandemic, we've held the lectures online. And this did at least give us the opportunity to invite speakers from far-flung lands. So the slide here, it was an illustration of our lecture this year, given by Dr. Jennifer Neville from Australia. Her topic was, I had to fight with the painters, master carpenters, actors, musicians, and the dancers. Subtitle, Rehearsals, Performance Problems, and Audience Reaction in Renaissance Spectacles. In Renaissance Europe, theatrical spectacles could be huge extravaganza. And when, for instance, a very important person came to town, or there was a grand wedding, and they could be much smaller scale things as well. They were often performed in front of the monarch, and the courtiers, they usually had a very serious political message. The courtiers themselves took part, as well as professional dancers. However, then as now, such multimedia events sometimes encountered problems during both rehearsals and performances. And such events formed the focus of Jennifer's paper, followed by an examination of the response to the spectators, of the spectators to such disasters. In the picture here, underneath the bottom box, this is a spectacle from the late 14th century where the king and some of the courtiers dressed up as wild men, and they were in costumes that were slathered with tar, which is highly flammable. And the king's brother, against the rules, brought his torch too close to one of the dancers, and they all caught alight. Fortunately, the king's aunt threw her dress over the king, so nothing happened to him, but there were tragic consequences. I think it's a pity you can't quite see the dancers catching alight. I'll move on now to the conference, and I'm the conference organizer. The Early Dance Circle hosts a major dance history conference every 2 years, and we publish the proceedings. There's an archive of information of our previous conferences on our website. The 2020 conference has been twice postponed due to COVID, but we do really hope that the conference next May will be live at St. Catherine's, Parmore. The topic of the conference next year will be retrieving and reconstructing the past through dance. Our conference attracts an international set of speakers on historical dance, topics spanning from the 15th to the 20th century. And this enables us to link with fellow historical dance organizations across Europe and even in America, Japan, and Australia. So I think our conference can be said to have a global reach. The conference also hosts early dance workshops and some performances, as well as general dancing. Since we couldn't have our conference this year, I organized a lecture by by Margaret McGowan, who's emeritus professor at Sussex University. Margaret's talk was on the interplay of professional and amateur dancers in early modern festivals. The text of the lecture is now available on our website. And we may continue with some online lectures into the future. We've got many publications, and our conferences certainly form a great part of these. So far, we've only produced the conferences as paper copies, but we are endeavoring to put all the proceedings of the conferences online for the future, and we'll try to get the previous conference publications there as well. We also publicize other publications, particularly transcriptions and translations of significant historical texts. And you can see various links on the website on the screen there. I think that's all I've got to say, and I've probably taken up my 7 minutes now. So back to Sharon.
Yes, and I've put some links in the chat. Sorry, Sharon. I've put some links in the chat for you to so people can learn and see the various publications that the EDC publishes and how you might get your hands on some of those publications. So over to you, Sharon.
Thanks very much, Rosa. And thanks to Bill and Barbara, too. That was all very clear and well done. Now, I'm going to move on to the ways in which we support research, learning, and performance. And luckily, although we are a small and totally voluntary organization, we have been the recipient of a number of generous donations, which have allowed us to maintain a small but steady series of awards. Some of these over the years have resulted in publications and others in performances. And many have supported summer schools or weekend schools to allow people to learn the dances, because one of our key principles is that it's not a matter of research on the page alone. Often these early sources are quite ambiguous, and it's not until a dancer with experience starts to try to put that page of material onto the dance floor that the real meaning of some of the material in it comes to light. And it's just so important that we support dance itself as well as research into sources. Now, for this purpose, we do have a whole series of small bursaries. They're not generous, but they are enough to allow individuals often to attend something they wouldn't normally be able to do, or a dance group to put on something that they wouldn't normally be able to afford. We've also occasionally supported schemes to put historical dance into the public arena, most notably with the Ramo project of a few years ago, where we paid to have the Baroque dancers take part at the Royal Festival Hall as part of the 400th anniversary of Rameau and his work. And immediately in the near future, the staging of two short Weaver ensemble productions on the same evening in January at the Steiner Theatre. Tickets are on sale for this. So you might want to look into it online. What they'll be putting on is a celebration of the work of John Weaver, an 18th century impresario, choreographer, dancer, and creator of what is sometimes called the very first modern ballet, The Loves of Mars and Venus. These aren't recreations, but they are highly entertaining, full of wonderful dance and music of the period, and well worth an evening in the theater to see something you wouldn't normally have the chance to see. we're trying to build an audience for early dance, as well as the historical background. Now, if we move on, we can have a look at other ways in which we support this through our archives and creating other resources. If we could have the next slide. Yeah, here we are. This is a picture of Barbara and me at the National Resource Center for Historical Dance at Kellogg College. It's quite a large collection, tightly focused on dance and costume. The two work together, and quite frequently one illuminates the other. Now, in addition to that, we can point out to people through these volumes, and particularly some of those on the social and historical background of this material, the way these social dances often are key to an understanding of certain characteristics of individual periods, economic assumptions perhaps, or philosophical ideas, unspoken attitudes to gender. There's all sorts of social historical material woven in to these dance manuals. They are not simply descriptions of steps and what dancers do. There's a whole lot of accompanying material, which is extremely valuable. And the way the dances migrate has a lot to say about colonialism and imperialism as well. Things which we are beginning to explore, have been exploring for the last 40 years, to be quite honest, but only recently via online materials. So if we have the next slide. One of those was created just last December, but it included material from a good many years ago, bringing to life the dances of Ignatius Sancho. And for that, you can see the whole thing on the EDC YouTube channel, and the link for that will be put up. It involved discussions and interviews with knowledgeable experts, but also some excerpts of performances going back over a number of years so that we can see these dances actually come alive. Our biggest project to date was a resource created for the Culture Moves project in a partnership with CEDAIR at the University of Coventry, for which we were immensely grateful. And we can see a little bit of that. I think Rosa will be able to share screen and show some of the video we created.
Yes, that is correct. No, can you see that?
Yes.
Okay. So it's a 23-minute video that was part of the MOOC that we developed within the Culture Moves project. So I'll just show you a little bit of the video, but it's online on the Culture Moves website. The intro has Sharon talking about the EDC, but also the audit that they did of Europeana and the content that's available or not available at that moment in time. And then we also captured Barbara teaching us some steps. So we will fast forward to that. Barbara holds a summer school. There we go. There's our lovely Barbara.
It's full of variety. I'm Barbara Siegel and I'm a Baroque dancer. I perform, I teach, I'm a dance historian. This is our 21st summer school, and we have Baroque dance, we have early music, singing, mostly Baroque singing, commedia, which is which was also very popular in the 18th century at the time that the dancing is done that I'm teaching, and of course costume making, and a lot of people are making Baroque costumes. In the 16th century, dance was really dominated by Italian dancing masters, and then at the beginning, in early 17th century, the French dancing masters developed a slightly different, or a quite a different style. This became belle dance, noble dance. In England, it was called French dancing. So it started at the court of Louis XIV in Paris. He loved dancing. Louis had a dancing class every day for 20, I think from the age of 6 to 22, he had a 2-hour dancing class. He was a bit upset that a lot of his courtiers couldn't do the dancing as well as he could. So he set up the Royal Academy of Dance in Paris in 1661 to teach the French belle dance. He really wanted the nobles to learn Baroque dance, but unfortunately for the nobles and for Louis, he allowed professionals to come in, and professionals were a lower class than the courtiers. And of course, they got so much better than the courtiers that the courtiers stopped dancing. So it didn't really advance Louis's purposes. But in the 15th and 16th century, there was no turnout of the feet. But in the 17th century, turnout, not 180 degrees of classical ballet, but 90 degrees. It was much higher up, much lighter on the feet. But the most important difference, I guess, was the use of arms with every step. So if you have a sort of double step, three steps in Renaissance times, your arms are here all the time. But in Baroque, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And Baroque dancing is very closely related to the music, because you use your arm, you use going up on your toe, but perhaps more significantly your arms, to mark the first beat of every bar. So it'll be 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And when I'm doing Baroque dance, I feel that I am conjuring up the music with my arms and my body.
Okay. Shall we leave it there then, and move on to an example of how we developed the MOOC for a long-term early dance resource? As it says here, it was filmed in 2019, and you must remember that the dancers you are watching learned the dances within that week and performed in costume at the end of it, which I think is quite an achievement. And the whole project wouldn't have been possible without EDC support from the Chalemie company foremost. And then as well, the CultureMoves project and Europeana, and we're very grateful for it. If we look at the next slide, we can see an example of the kind of notation that's appended to the resource. So you can see the two gents. I thought interesting to show two men dancing together. It's such a rarity. And the beautiful, beautiful notation. And the next slide also gives an idea of the kinds of tasks that we set as part of the MOOC, but are included in the final resource. Things we hoped for many different kinds of people watching the course. It's meant to be an introduction, as it says. Some of them are image-based. Some of them are related very much to how Baroque dance could play a part today. And of course, the thing about it is it's such a broad spectrum. The resource shows couple dancing primarily, beautiful court couple dancing, But within the range of Baroque dance, there is set dancing and there is comic dancing. And you see that as well on the resource. The kinds of material that Baroque dancers can present within a historical setting show people, I think, the huge range of mindset within a culture. It's not all just people showing off their beautiful clothes and prancing about. There's a little bit of that. Everybody likes to show off their new clothes, but it's also about interaction within a group and how a society presents itself as a harmonious whole. And it can be immensely participative because some of the dances are not difficult, and a good teacher can involve the audience in what's going on the dance floor, and they can be part of the scene. You probably noticed some audience participation in one of our slides already. And it has, I think, a lot to offer within the tourist industry to involve people in the past and make them feel they've had an experience of what went before, not just through the eyes, but through the whole body. And age is not necessarily any deterrent to this, because many of the dances can be enjoyed by people of any age and pretty average fitness. Now, we can move on now to what really is probably our greatest single resource, and that is our groups. We have a goodly number, but today we're going to hear from someone who's very important in the Norwich Historical Dance Group. And here he is on the end, looking very grand, and he's going to tell you a bit about how they work, particularly with historic settings, but in other ways as well. Chris?
Thank you, Sharon. Right, I'm Chris Gill. I'm do some dancing with Norwich Historical Dance. Well, we enjoy helping audiences to discover their dance heritage, both, as it says there, by watching and by taking part. We place our dancers in their historical cultural context, performing in costume and often with live music, which is great. Norwich, of course, is known as a city of dance for many reasons, not least its links to John Playford, who was born and educated there, and the Novaires. As part of this connection, Norwich Historical Dance hold an annual Playford Ball, fittingly in the Novaire Room of the Assembly House in Norwich. And we had a very successful one a couple of weeks ago. We've worked with local museums, the Norfolk Record Office and other local groups to take the message of dance and its connections to the County of Norfolk and to a wider audience. And this includes stately homes and manors, local galas and fetes, and also Kingsland's Hans Festival, where we go back to about the 14th, 15th century. One group we are looking to work with more closely is the Paston Society, who have created a brilliant interactive website which allows the public and schools to learn more about this fascinating local family whose 300-year story is well recorded in their many surviving letters, as well as their buildings and even the unique painting, the Paston Treasure, which is now in Norwich Castle Museum. To date, we've worked with the Paston Society in the supply of video and still images for use on the website, and there is room for more cooperation as they continue its development. In the months before COVID-19 hit us, we were preparing for a full-scale show about the Pastons, presented as a dancing play and covering the centuries of their rise and fall. It was commissioned by Swaffham Arts, for whom we have previously created similar shows around local events, such as a Georgian Assembly and a commemoration of the start of the First World War, which took us briefly into the 20th century and contrasted the old country dancers and their newer ragtime. It also looked at the effects of war in a small town. It was about an hour and a half long. We have actively worked in schools as well, for example, teaching some simple country dances to pupils in Thetford, who then performed them with our group in a show about Thomas Paine, a native of the town. Apparently he didn't like dancing much, but anyway, while the children learnt about a local famous person, as well as the costume, typical music and dances of the time, they also had to remember steps and some basic aspects of performance. Coming up in 2022, Norwich Historical Dance have been asked to contribute to a project for local primary school pupils called Putting on a Pageant, POP 1578. This is a free online heritage education programme about Elizabeth I's progress in Norwich and has been funded by the Arts Council, the University of East Anglia and others. We will be filmed performing Tudor dances in costume to live authentic music, and I believe some of this film will be used in with connection with headsets so they get an all-round visual feeling for it. Dancing is much more enjoyable when performed to live music, and Norwich Historical Dance have a core of musicians with whom we've worked down the years. The presence of the musicians with their instruments of the period can be of great interest to the audience, especially young people. Indeed, at a performance in Wyndham Abbey, early music group Hexacordia demonstrated different Tudor period instruments as part of the event. The involvement of the audience becomes closer when they are invited to join us in a dance or two, usually at the end of a display. This may be the first time they have ever moved to music in this way, and we usually get a good response. In July 2015, two Chinese students from the University of East Anglia, Heting Zhang and Yaran Zhao, were on a broadcast journalism course, and they worked with BBC Voices to make a documentary on Norwich Historical Dance and their research and recreation of dances and costumes from past centuries. And this is now, it can be found online as well. Membership of the group is open to anyone and has included students from the university, the local hospital and secondary schools, one of whom joined initially as part of a Duke of Edinburgh award and became so enthusiastic that she now promotes and teaches early dance to others. We completely understand her joy and pleasure in dancing, and we hope to continue to inspire others. Thank you. Back to Sharon.
Thank you very much, Chris. And Norwich is probably one of our foremost groups, particularly for their outreach and their range of skills and the range of periods that they dance. But there are many other groups throughout the country, from Scotland all the way down to the coast, the South Coast, who have similar outreach, who work locally to help integrate dance and help local people take part in a dance tradition which belongs to them. We mentioned at the start that it is closely connected with the courts, but that is partly an accident of preservation. Dance has always been something for the people and continues to be today. And lots of early dance can be highly participative and also extremely healthy. We have a good many older members. And I like to think that one of the reasons is that dance keeps you fit and healthy and your mind alive well into, shall we say, late middle age. But however, at the moment, we're very concentrated on trying to get some younger people involved as well. Not that there aren't any, but we could do with more. Now, if we look at the next slide, I can move on to an important area, but one which is extremely accessible online, our website. We have two at least key pages. One is a way for people to find out where to learn the dances, the groups and societies and classes page. And people who want to find a local group can look there and discover what there is in their area and find contact details for it. And in addition to that, we have a resources area. Now, it is full of stuff and does need some reorganization. And we do plan to work on the website in the next few months. But to give you a taste of how much use we get, in the last year, our usage figures from Google Analytics have gone up by 14,000 page views. In fact, most of the pages are now receiving at least a third more searches than they have in the past. Many of these searches come from the United States. Oddly enough, we have quite a few from the Philippines, and we're still trying to figure out how that happens. But the UK, Canada, Australia, and Europe contribute quite a bit, as does China, oddly enough, and Indonesia. But the most popular pages are our resources pages. And to give you a hint of what's in them, we can go to the next slide. Yes, Dance Through History is a free period by period survey of the history of dance. And in a moment, I'll show you the periods that we cover. But equally important is learning the dances. And practice is just as important as theory and scholarship. And there is material there to help people not just locate a dance group, but also find music and books to help them if they're working in a group. And then we have an area with music for dancing. It doesn't contain music resources, but points towards them. And then on the next slide, there's a small breakdown of what is in the resources of Dance Through History. There are pages on all these topics, with extensive bibliographies for people to do their own reading, taking this as a jumping off point. We try to keep it up to date. It's a big task, but many, many people have contributed to it. The most popular area is the early 20th century, but it's closely followed by the 17th and 18th centuries, and Regency is becoming more and more popular as more dance groups in the UK take it up. Now, I think we're beginning to run into a time problem. So at this point, I think we could turn to an even more important, at least growing in importance, the area of the YouTube channel, social media, and briefly, the legacy of the pandemic. And we do have Louise Manico with us today, who will talk a little bit about this area where she helps us a great deal.
Thank you. As has already been mentioned, most of our events have been face-to-face in the past, but obviously with the pandemic, things changed. So to keep our members engaged and connected, more and more stuff moved online, and social media became a really important way for us to keep in touch with our members and attract new followers and attendees for our events. We knew that some of the groups that we worked with were posting activities and doing meetings online, so we were keen to build on what they'd already started. Broadly speaking, Facebook seems to appeal to other dance groups and those that are more actively engaged with performing early dance, and Twitter seems to be more academic and research, although there's obviously crossover between them. Our Facebook page and our Twitter pages have got an increased number of followers, particularly over the last year or so when we've ramped up our online activities. We've also got Pinterest boards online, which can act as a point of reference visually for any early dance participants or researchers. We have mentioned before as well that our festival has been held online and was a massive success. So that's helped us to increase the amount of footage that we include on our YouTube channel as well. It's always nice for people to be able to see historical dance and early dance. So we've got footage from the previous year's festivals on YouTube, and we're looking at more and more ways to get more engaging material on there. And just to sum up, because we're short on time, it's really good to be able to interact with people on social media. Obviously, there's no barrier in terms of geography or time or ability or anything like that. We're always really keen to engage with other dancers or historians or anyone with an interest in what we do, so that we can further our own understanding too.
I think that brings our presentation almost to a close, but Bill would like to make some concluding comments as chair. You need to unmute, Bill.
Right, my assistant is doing that now. Yes, it's my duty to sum up the discussion that we've had so far. I have just 3 minutes and 5 points to make by way of summary. The first is, the thing that we are focused on is primarily one aspect of intangible cultural heritage, and that is dance in its historical context. Secondly, in order to do this, serious historical research is required. And the EDC sponsors this research through its conferences, its support for students to study dance, and the large archive of material that we have up in Oxford at the Kellogg College. The third point I'd like to make is that we're very much involved in engaging the public through performance in historic buildings, for one thing, also in other spaces. But the animation of these wonderful historic buildings is very much part of what we like to see happening and which we endeavor to sponsor in one way or another. Animating buildings, animating our tangible cultural heritage, you could say. We also sponsor professional performance through activities such as the ones that Sharon has mentioned with the Weaver Ensemble and the Ramo Project. My fourth point is that we endeavor to encourage wide social participation in dance activities related to the historical repertoire. And in this respect, we want to make the whole thing accessible to a very wide public by sponsoring summer schools hosted by member societies, by bursaries to students, through performance and audience engagement in performance. So all of this is part of the endeavor that on our part to encourage wide social participation in dance. As I think it was, it may have been Sharon mentioned, it is a very healthy pursuit. I have noted that John Weaver, the famous dancing master, actually he died at 87, which is a very good age for this, in I think around 1760 or something, a very good age at that period, and he was dancing right to the end. So there it is the health value is not to be underestimated. That's my fourth point. My fifth and last point is the way in which all this activity is supported by a technological underpinning. I mean, this is where we link back to Europeana, Weave, and even this little Zoom interchange. It has proved to be invaluable to have the latest in technology to support this engagement with historic dance. It would not have been possible 10 or 20 years ago to collect video material in the way that we have done, to build archives, to show this material, to collect things and allow others to participate in both the collection and interrogation of these databases. So the link into Europeana, Weave, and other projects of this kind, which essentially depend upon this technology and in a sense also drive the technology. I was to coin a phrase, I mean, the past is no longer a foreign country. It is all becoming increasingly accessible. And that is, I think, our principal objective. With that, I don't think I have anything more to say, but that is my summary of what the EDC is involved in. And I think at this point, Sharon, Rosa, do we open it up to the audience for questions and any comments?
Yes, thank you so much, everyone, to all of the EDC members, to Chris, to Louise, to everyone who's been in the space. We'd love to have any questions, comments. I just am very grateful to, you know, have you presenting and sharing all of the work you're doing as an umbrella organization in the UK. And also, we've seen a taste of different videos, different material that's been created or that's, you know, part of the archive. And a lot of that footage is actually going into Europeana, and we're in the process of gathering that content and sharing it, and going through the various stages that it has to go through before it ends up in Europeana. But that process is happening, and we're very excited to be able to include early dance and historical dance content into Europeana via this Weave project. I see there's a comments from Galway Early Music 1996, who says, thank you for a fascinating morning. We in Galway Early Music have always included dance in our festivals, and we believe it is such an important part of the historical past we are presenting in music. Love all the activities and hadn't heard about Europeana. Definitely will be looking further. Excellent. I didn't know if you wanted to maybe talk a little bit about your festivals and the difference, or how that when you bring in dance, what maybe happens, or how, what changes the festival? Maybe it's a big question, I know, but
it's a big question. Very briefly, it's an early music festival, and we cover medieval, Renaissance, and Baroque music, very small, on the west coast of Ireland. So Galway is the most westerly early music festival almost in Europe. I hear there's one in Portugal that's further west, but the early music festivals often only have music, but so much of the music that we play is actually dance music. And when you put dancing with the music, it changes the music a lot. You have to play the music differently. And I think that it's something very important for musicians who are playing the music to get that experience of playing with dancers, because it is, isn't it? It's just a totally different thing from listening. And I love dance, so I've been involved in in the programming. So I always try to bring dance in. One of the most popular things in the festival is our dance workshops, and we always have a dance workshop. So from that point of view, you can see that people want to move to music and that they are interested in the historical aspect. So we have tried to always maintain that in the festival, even though it's specifically an early music festival, but we always get that dance in there. I really think it's important and fun.
Thank you for that. Chris, you also touched a bit on the relationship and the importance of your group and that relationship between the dancers and musicians. I didn't know if you wanted to add anything.
No, it is so much more pleasant to dance with live music. We do have Hexacordia, who often play with us, or for us, should I say. Harriet, who's one of the main people in the group, is our sort of musical director, and she rearranges the music for however many instruments are required. So we have a sort of ad hoc music we can bring together, depending on the era and so on. So yeah, it's really good to be able to have the live music and people who understand how to play for people who are dancing, because I also tour with a local Ceilidh band, just occasionally you have to sort of say no, don't do it like that, because people have to dance to it. So when they go off at a tangent, you say no, look, we've got dancers. If you want to do that in the interval. So it's there's music for dancing, and I didn't learn that till a few years ago. One of my daughters danced with a ballet group, and I said to the teacher, I've got that piece of music on a CD. And she said, that's no good. It's played totally the wrong speed, you know. So you sort of learn as you go along. But it's definitely nice to have the music there if you can afford it and if it's available.
Yes, thank you. I see a hand up from Abida. Did you want to...
Yes. Hi, Rosa. Thank you. I feel like I've come a bit left field to this project. I've been interested in, well, I would say Regency dance, because I've always had an interest in period dramas, and so often those dances are quite pivotal in a play. But from a completely different perspective, working in archives and museums, I come from Somalia, and so some of the challenges I've found, and you mentioned colonialism and imperialism, and a lot of objects and archival material was brought over, but actually not without the context, and particularly considering Somali culture is very oral based, has a lot of movement, and so the idea of intangible heritage and animating the past through through dance, through either work songs, and so it was really interesting to hear, I guess, your perspective, and I'm interested more in the kind of methodology around how you're drawing out the archival and other materials to be able to kind of connect the two. I think definitely technology does have a ability to be able to bring all those together. I did a project called the Nomad Project, and we used something called motion capture, which is where you wear a suit and then you're able to actually mimic the movement, and then that can be experienced in a kind of immersive space. So if you're interested in virtual reality or mixed reality, you can bring together movement with object and sound. But I definitely think what you're exploring has a lot of connection to heritage that have historically either been kind of collected and organized in a way where there is very little context, or doesn't reflect how the dynamic nature of how their heritage was practiced. And so, yeah, I see a lot of parallels between the work that you're doing and some of the work that others are doing to bring kind of either more hidden histories or marginalized histories, kind of, and making them participatory. Because actually, when you do go into a museum and you see an object that's on a plinth, it doesn't really reflect who the people were that made it, what might have happened around it, what songs might have happened. And also, particularly with our heritage, it's quite communal. So women would be sitting around weaving, all of that sometimes is lost. And so I think the opportunity to always kind of bring in movement and people, I think, is integral to be able to A, share the heritage in a way that's much more engaging. And I think people find it much more engaging to be able to participate than just kind of see something very static and then kind of walking past it. So yeah, I just wanted to share that perspective.
Thank you. Thank you, Abira. And yes, we've been in touch, and it's one of the goals within Weave is just that, how can we frame and look at the past and this archival material, whatever that might be. That might be an embodied history. And how do we bring that forward, and how do we document that? How do we pull some of that together? Fortunately, we're able to have this space where we can take items that might not have the right language or might be using an outdated term, and we can start to say, well, and frame that a bit better. And so whether that's the Roma community, whether that's Portuguese folk dance, whether it's early dance, whether it's the Slovenian castles, we're looking at how we can create a narrative around that to frame it. So if it is maybe built on terms that might be colonial, that might be offensive, that might be really reflecting a very specific period, we can start to discuss that and say, okay, what can we do now? So within the Weave project, we also have a strand of capacity building and a toolkit that and the tools that we're developing that help us look at these various strands. And fortunately, we have the exhibitions and the galleries and the collections that are allowing us to really offer insight into that, those nuances that might be lost with just maybe a digitized item standing there. So yes, that's a lot of what we're trying to do. Of course, it's an ongoing iterative process, but we're using ourselves within the project and the organizations, whether that's the archive, the programmers, the universe, the researchers, the dancers, which is a bit of this lab day methodology, so that the community members from those spaces can also direct us. You know, today's lab day, we really get a sense of what the EDC is doing, so that they can direct us on how to best frame the content that's coming into Europeana. And the same is true for the Roma community's content, the Portuguese folk dance, the Castellers. So again, how do we think about what kinds of questions we need to ask ourselves to help us connect those dots and create this fuller story and picture? I don't know if any of the other Weave partners want to say something on that comment. I know we have Stefan, who's one of the developers. We have Marie-Louise, Sarah, Valentina. You're welcome to reply as well. Or if the EDC would like to say anything, yes.
We find the community aspect of the dance has got different facets in the sense that in the past, in many of the communities whose dances we look at now, the set dancing is very important for building cohesion. And also, I suspect, for providing a way of calming anxiety inside a group. I sometimes think when you look at the Regency period, if you only look at the buildings and the symmetrical arrangement of them, it seems such a calm era. It wasn't at all a calm era. And so people had to somehow instill in each other this sense of control and beauty of movement and gracefulness in the teeth of what was actually going on. Now, of course, when European dance forms through imperialism went into other cultures, there too, although they were in a sense an imposition within those cultures, they're taken up again and used by those people in ways that express and enhance their own individuality and their own need for community. There is something about social dance which is immensely valuable, it seems to me, and we neglect it in our own age at our peril, really. It's incredibly healthy. We've made that point before, but there has been a lot of research into effect of not only memorizing the steps, but using them in concert with other people, using eye contact and having to coordinate across a group like that, having a hugely beneficial effect on the body and the mind. But also socially, I think there's a big beneficial effect, and you don't have to be trained to do it. And you don't have to be young, and you don't have to be particularly fit. I mean, if you want to be a virtuosic dancer, yes, you do. And that has a place too in the history of dance. But there are other aspects which are quite important.
Okay. Yeah. When you're talking there about social dancing, one of the other things I suppose is brought to mind there was Janella with her blind dance group.
Oh, yes.
You know, yes. That was quite fascinating. She ran for many years with teaching people to dance in formation when they were blind, and that was quite incredible. And I've heard of other people doing it with other people with other disabilities as well. So just it's inclusive, but it also promotes coordination and memory.
Thank you. There is a question.
I was just going to comment that this whole issue of the relationship between dance and health is actually a very important one, and probably deserves an entire conference on its own. My own particular research is in the way in which it was used in the 18th century, in the 19th century, as part of the standard but support methods within the asylums of Britain. It was very widely used in that for its mental improvement benefits. So another issue which the Early Dance Circle has been involved in, and many of our participating groups are quite closely involved in that, but it's a big issue that would well warrant an entire conference on its own. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for that. And we have just about 2-3 minutes left, but I do want to get to Sally Lewis's question that says, thank you for this comprehensive account and your enthusiasm. Are you able to say any more about what you are doing to engage more young people in your work, particularly those not studying dance formally? Over to the EDC. Thank you, Sally, for the question.
Sharon.
Well, it's not, yes, it's not our strong suit, I'm afraid. We try all sorts of things. It used to be that the curriculum was a big help at first. When the Tudors and the Elizabethans were on the primary school curriculum, we were regularly, many, many groups were regularly invited into schools. And when secondary schools had money for enrichment activities, my particular group was invited every year to do Regency dance with pupils. But thanks to COVID and thanks to cutbacks, pretty nearly all of this has disappeared in recent years. Now, areas we try is simply public performance, of course. We are having a special meeting in the next few months to discuss just this topic because it arose at the AGM and people are concerned about it. You run across the problem that was rampant in education when I was in education, and that is the statement that we did that 10 years ago and it didn't work. But that doesn't necessarily mean it won't work this time. So we do need to recreate some of our strategies, but also I do think, judging from some of the people that I know who've moved into early dance, that universities might prove to be a good recruiting ground. And we need to make more contact with student services and student activities in universities. But we're open to any and all suggestions, please. Now, anybody else want to add to this? From EDC, or
I would just like to say on that point, I think that's where technology is going to be really useful as well in helping to reach a whole new demographic and reach them more easily. We just need to figure out the ways to do it more effectively. I think at the minute we're using social media channels that are traditionally now used by the older generations. Like, we need to start messing around on TikTok and all those kinds of things, you know, to make it. But yeah, I can see the look of horror on some of the committee's faces. But we need to be where they are rather than expecting them to come to us. And I think there's something that we just need to keep working on. We need to make sure that we're up to date, even though we're working on a historical subject.
Well, when my grandson, who is 7, tells me that his favorite topic at the moment is the Middle Ages, I don't think youngsters are immune to the allure of history. He was taken to a reenactment event and he hasn't stopped talking about it since August. So there's hope.
Thank you, thank you. So on that note, I expect everyone to get a TikTok account and start TikToking historical dance. And yes, thank you so much to everyone involved. It's been a real pleasure to start to scratch the surface of some bigger questions here. I think we could keep sharing and learning from each other. Thanks to everyone involved. We look forward to sharing the contents once it's on Europeana, either through the exhibitions or the editorials that we are creating. We have do visit the Weave website. We have a series of lab days planned for January and until April on capacity building. We have tools, we have opportunities for people to engage with the tools that we're developing. We also have a toolkit, and there'll be lots of other things. So do visit our website, follow our newsletter, follow us on our social media accounts, and also do feel free to follow the EDC, maybe even, you know, become a member, who knows. Thank you again to everyone, and as always, we leave this lab day with a bit of music, so thank you so much. Thank you.